610 ESPN Philadelphia. We have Randy Miller and Ari Rosenfeld in the studio. Gentlemen, Nova is Nova, and the rest of the city is really struggling this year. So what I'd like to do is talk a little bit about what these guys are doing and what you think they should be doing in terms of recruiting to bring the programs back to prominence. And I think we have a caller that can fill us in on our first subject, Mr. Matt Gifford, Hawk Hill Hardwood. Is that right, Matt?
That is correct, though. You got it.
I appreciate it.
I send this one out to my right-hand man, or men's, or women's, the whole crew, real fan. We could count the dough or kick up the what, chill out watching videos or acting really silly, yo, but really though, all I could end. Whether at the bar with superstars or cruising in a trooper car, I really don't care who you are, all I really need is a friend. Can't have trust, then you can't hang with us. We respond to those who show respect with respect. We respond, we connect on the same deck, same intellect. My man, never shifty things quickly if you can't understand. We boys, we can stand on the corner with a hat selling toys. It ain't about your bends, I hope it ain't about mine, my man. I be dissing in my freestyle rhyme, getting cheese around the world.
I appreciate you calling in, Matt. We really do. I know you know Randy and Ari and Eric.
I know, I feel honored to join them. Absolutely.
Well, what's up, Matt?
It's an honor to have you here. The Hawks come in at a struggling 5-22. They have a chance to get that sixth win tonight in St. Louis, correct?
That is correct. Yeah, they play at 9:00 tonight at St. Louis.
And they're 1-13 in the A-10. So the question I want to put before you, Matt, is who are they recruiting? How's it going? And who do you think they should be pursuing with all deliberate purpose and speed here in Philadelphia?
Yeah, absolutely. That's a great question. So I think the thing that's really fascinating with St. Joe's this year is, I mean, 5-22, there's not necessarily a ton that you can say there. They've put together some decent halves. They've put together a couple good games. I mean, coming back and beating Davidson last week was one of the high points this year, for sure.
Huge, especially from that deficit. That was big.
Absolutely, and to do that without Ryan Daly, and to do that in the first half where you were, I mean, I personally briefly turned it off. I mean, it did not look like it was going to turn around at all. So the thing that's just so interesting about them is the roster construction this season, and then, yeah, we're going to talk recruiting for sure, but, like, just the difference between what their starting five is currently and what that starting five will look like next year, just because, I mean, you have, as you know, but for people that are listening that may not, conceivably you have three or four guys that'll start next year that currently are not playing, between Greg Foster Jr., who is sitting out from Gonzaga, you have Demir Bishop sitting out from Xavier, Taylor Funk is out with injury. So, I mean, I don't know what your guys' thoughts on that are, but I think that conceivably you could see all three of those guys starting next year.
Mm-hmm. So who do you think they should be going after? Who they hot on, man?
Yeah, so in 2020, so they're pretty much done for 2020 with the exception that they're still looking for a big man, and they're hoping to plug in someone there. But 21, so those are the juniors. That class is one where they're just really, really guard heavy and wing heavy in terms of what they're going after. So some of the names that you guys were just discussing are people that they are currently going after. I mean, and how realistic these targets are, it can be a very long conversation, but I'll answer your question, Della, to who they're looking at and hot after. So that would be Rasul Diggins.
Mm-hmm.
That would be Nicene Poplar. Mm-hmm. That would be, so those are two guys right there that are, I mean, would you guys both argue the two best guards in the city? Probably, or two of the best
Justice,
guards in the city.
I would throw Justice.
And Justice as well. Oh, yeah, sorry. I was specifically be in
2020. By the time school starts back up, Justice may be over those guys. I mean, it's close.
Oh, yeah, I would.
I wouldn't argue that.
Yes.
Yeah, I wouldn't argue against Justice in any capacity, period. And he's a guy that I would imagine that wouldn't really be practical for St. Joe's to recruit. I could be wrong. They might try, but I don't see how that's a great use of resources, other than that they're so close. But
what about Mitchell?
He's another tier.
They're still on Stevie Mitchell?
They are. Yeah, so he was going to be kind of that third guy I was going to go at here locally. So Stevie Mitchell, Russell Diggins, Nicene Poplar are all guys that are going to be recruited way above St. Joe's, but are guys that they've been hot on for some time, and I think will continue to be until they're told that they can't be. So locally as well, you have Deshaun Shepherd from Archbishop Wood. So he's a wing that they've offered.
They offered Shepherd?
They did.
Ed Holland.
So, I mean, in terms of...
Did you offer Ed Holland?
Yes.
They did offer Ed Holland.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say, so Holland, obviously, the academic piece, will be super fascinating to follow with his recruitment in terms of his offers that come in.
What about Taquan Woodley? Have they offered Taquan Woodley?
So that's a good question. I know that they've...
Been in touch with him.
I know that they've been in touch with him. I do not know, Dell, if that's an offer or not. In fact, in terms of, like, non-guards, I was going through everything that I have here. I mean, I guess you call Ed Holland a combo forward? Probably?
I call it a wing.
Wing forward.
I think a wing.
Ed's a wing.
He's a wing.
Maybe. Okay, so you have Ed as a wing.
A wing.
You've got Shepherd as kind of a wing guy. But then in terms of, like a big, really the only one that I have with an offer right now is Anquan Hill from Archbishop Carroll.
So they like
in terms of big
offer Hill before Woodley. That's interesting.
I mean, I could be wrong on that. I don't know.
I know they offered
again,
Hill.
Again, I know that.
I know they offered Hill as well.
Offer.
And I don't think they offered Taquan. What do you think about what St. Joe should be doing, Randy? You like that list? Anybody missing?
I do like the list. You know, they just taking over the program, so they have to, you know, they have to
go after those guys.
Yeah, so I think they're very, very smart in going after some transfers, just to help jumpstart the program because they need immediate help.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, the addition of Greg Foster should be, you know, very key. They also have, oh my goodness.
I mean, Jordan Hall coming in next year.
Jordan Hall will make a big difference. Damir.
Yeah.
I had a brain freeze for a
second. Damir will be like January.
Yeah, exactly. So he'll.
Well, it wouldn't surprise me if
he
could get eligible.
Yeah.
You like that list, Ari?
I think it's a good list. You know, like anything, you know, Matt kind of touched on it. It's that balance of you kind of got to recruit the kids in your backyard until they tell you you can't recruit them anymore. If you know, when they're kind of blowing up and getting some of these higher level offers. That's kind of the nature of being.
I mean,
kind of
underlying what you guys are saying. Y'all feel like they reaching a little bit. Those guys may end up higher than the A-10.
Yeah, I mean, but we're talking Stevie Rasul, and I forget who the third. Yeah, Wooga. I mean, those guys all got Power 5 offers.
But as a recruiter, you have to go. You have to throw your hat in the ring.
You have to make them tell you no.
So Matt touched on that just a bit ago, right, Matt? When you talked about. When you're referring to Justice saying that he is not in a tier that St. Joe's would kind of waste resources on, right?
Yeah, and then I sort of auto-corrected because but at the same token, like, Roman Catholic is how far from St. Joe's?
Right, so that's kind of my question. When you see recruiting, right, and you see guys who are what you think maybe out of your league, I still like the aggressiveness going after those types of kids because it shows that you're not afraid and you feel like you could be just as good a landing spot for a kid as any other school could be.
I mean, I guess at the same time, when's the last time, you know, Justice is ranked, no matter where you look, top 30, top 40 in his class. When's the last time a top 30, top 40 kid went to the A-10, specifically went to St. Joe's? It's been a long time.
But.
And you got, I mean, it's a matter of resources.
Was borderline
it's a matter of
top 100.
Time.
CJ Aiken was borderline.
Borderline top 100 is different than top 30, top 40. But Hassan French is borderline top 100.
But
yeah, that's different than top 30, top 40.
So here's what me as a recruiter would be selling to kids who are, say, those top 30, those top 40 kids at an A-10 or at a lower level conference. You can come here and be a star, and you can make a name for yourself nationally and possibly reach your dreams of becoming a pro. As opposed to going to one of those blue blood schools where you're hunting for that offer and hoping to get on that roster and hoping to get on the floor. I'm going to sell my program as the place where you can come land and you can be a star today and be a star for however long you want to be.
That's not a track record of that. Are
the lists, would the lists be identical for LaSalle? You know, they're 13 or 14 overall, but they're just 4-11 in the A-10, and they're struggling as well. Do you think there should be a complete overlap in who LaSalle is targeting, or is there any differentiation between LaSalle and St. Joe?
It's the same league and then the same city, so obviously there's a lot of overlap there. And also you got guys on both staffs from D.C. with close ties down there, so you got a lot of the similar guys down there. The one thing I at least know dealing with St. Joe's a decent amount is I do know at least they're kind of very specific on like recruiting to this plan that they see for their roster of like really playing positionless, shooting a bunch of threes, right. Have 4 or 5 guys who can all push the ball up. That's why I think they got a great, great piece for that with Jordan Hall coming in next year because he just fits that to a T. So that's maybe where you'll see some of the lack of overlap is they're very specific of like, you know, kind of the type of guys that they want to recruit basketball wise for the team that they see ultimately having when they're successful.
Okay, let's throw Temple in the discussion because they're in the American, which it's I don't know if I would say openly that it's a better league, but it's different.
A little more athletic.
Memphis,
you say?
Yes, bigger, like more conference, athletic.
Conference USA.
Especially on the top end of it. You know, you got Memphis and you got Cincinnati,
right.
SMU, UCF. Who do you think Temple should be really pursuing? The guys I know they are pursuing are Woodley and Wooga and Stevie Mitchell.
I'll say a few more are Zach Hicks.
Zach Hicks.
Who's already been on an official there. Guy they've been seeing a lot recently, who like kind of the mainstream Philly people might not know, is Sam Onu, who came into the
Big
Phelps
Sam,
school this year.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. 6'11", looks like a high major big man, like physically, still kind of coming along with his skills. Monty Roth has been going to see him a lot recently, and Coach McKee as well. I think he's kind of right there
like
with
Temple
Woodley,
too,
if they can get one of those guys as their front court piece.
Go ahead, Matt.
No, I was going to say, and I feel like, I mean, and so we're talking about like tiers a little bit here. One guy that we haven't touched upon that clearly is one of the best prospects over on the area, Jalen Worley from Westtown. And I know recently, like, again, 24/7 came out with their updated list today, and they have him 30th in the country. So he's in that top tier there. But I know that when he was interviewed recently, he mentioned Temple as one of the schools that he was hearing from the most, whether that means it's one of the schools highest on his list or they're trying the hardest with him. But he's certainly a guy that Temple has been after really hard.
One guy that we haven't said was Jordan Longino.
Mm-hmm.
Aaron McKee loves his game.
Hard not to.
Yeah. Now he's going to have, what has he got? Like
he's got Ohio Virginia's State, and, Virginia, yep. Maryland.
So is that out of reach for Temple? It shouldn't be.
So it shouldn't. As you already know, like with recruiting, you have, you know, the makeup of the school, the program, or whatever the case may be. But, you know, recruiting is based on relationships as well. True. And so if those relationships are, you know, are strong and, you know, you can, you know, stay in the mix long enough and present yourself well and sell your program and your school well enough, hey, you never know what could happen.
And you got some Germantown Academy ties on the Temple staff as well, which I think if Jordan were to end up at Temple, which I wouldn't predict that he is, but if he were to end up there, I think that would play a big part in it.
Kids like Robert Smith and Hasir Miller, we haven't mentioned them, but we're talking about A-10.
Mm-hmm.
And let's include Drexel. Are they automatic guys that Drexel should be offering? And should the A-10 schools also be taking a look at a guy like Robert Smith?
Drexel's offer fade.
Yes, they offer.
Mm-hmm. They offer fade. And I know for a fact that Coach likes Robert Smith. And I'm not sure if they have enough space for him this year, but I know he sat behind me at the Roman.
He likes G too. And G, he didn't offer him.
Big G?
Spike.
Ryan.
Offers. Okay. Yeah. Okay. He likes G.
He likes Big G. I'm not sure why he didn't offer him, But because, I mean, I asked him. I said, you like Robert Smith? You like him enough to offer him? He was like, yeah, I like him, but we don't have any space right now. Mm-hmm. So that might, you know, play a part, but they definitely should be looking at him.
Are those guys capable of competing at the A-10 level, Miller, Smith?
I'll be honest, I think Miller more than Smith. Mm-hmm. He's just got a little bit more positional versatility, where I think Man is kind of stuck, you know, as that one position guy at the point, where so many of these teams want guys that can play multiple spots. I think anywhere, NEC, America East, even MEAC. MEAC, up to the MAC.
Big South.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a really good range for Man, Rob Smith. I think, you know, he could be on someone's A-10 roster and certainly not embarrass himself and hold his own. But what I tell people a lot is, like, these coaches are looking for guys that are going to help them win their league, not just guys who are going to keep them afloat or keep them at the bottom of the league. That's who you get fired.
Yeah.